Very few people would enjoy getting eaten by a bear in the woods. That would undeniably be an extremely unpleasant thing to happen to anyone. Heck, it's certainly enough to put a damper on an otherwise fun weekend of camping. But the one consolation of undergoing such a tragedy is that you at least know nature is taking its course. After all, bears live in the woods, and if you decide to enter their turf, there's an unwritten agreement that you'll just accept the consequences if a bear decides it doesn't want your company. It's another thing entirely if a bear eats you in your bedroom in the middle of suburbia, miles away from any nearby forest. That's the unfortunate fate that befell little Tommy Ellis. His parents heard the bellowing roar of a bear upstairs, the floorboards creaking under its sudden weight.
What was happening up there?
They ran upstairs, following the sounds of the roars and Tommy's horrible screams. But by the time they reached the bedroom, it was already too late. The room was empty, torn apart from within as a 600-pound grizzly bear crawled its way out of the destroyed bedroom window. Tommy Ellis was never seen again. To Tommy's parents, before they were given amnestic treatment by agents of the SCP Foundation, it was a freakish one-off tragedy. But to those very same Foundation agents, it was just another instance in a series of deaths so strange and random that only some kind of anomalous serial killer could be behind it. 2 months earlier, in a nearby town, a family had undergone a savage attack from a full-size male silverback gorilla. The huge and heavily territorial animal tore the house apart and beat anyone who tried to stop it into a pulp. Much like a bear attack, being killed by an aggressive gorilla in the wild isn't that strange, but being murdered by a gorilla in the suburbs of Cincinnati is definitely a cause for Foundation intervention. However, the gorilla killer was long gone before any Foundation agents were able to intervene. At first, it was assumed that they were dealing with some kind of animal SCP, but as more grisly murders occurred, it began to paint a better picture of what exactly was happening here. Next, a family was found dead after what had seemed to be a brutal attack with an edged weapon, but this was no mere knife. All the evidence pointed to the weapon being a sword. Neighbors interviewed by the Foundation about the attack before their amnestic treatment reported hearing a frightening ruckus coming from the house next door, including a deep male voice saying,
"I have the power!"
Much like He-Man from the popular toy and animation franchise. This reminded them of another recent murder case where the killer also reportedly used a sword, though this time more likely a Japanese katana than a European broadsword, and was heard yelling,
"Cowabunga!"
as they left the scene. As the bodies racked up, the evidence kept piling on. A young girl was traumatized by a naked man suddenly appearing in her bedroom. This would be horrible enough, but there were a few strange details. He was handsome, athletic, had bright blonde hair, and no genitals. In fact, he matched the exact description of a child's Ken doll. And the thing that finally tied this whole bizarre case together was an entire family who was found to have been killed by electrocution, despite all being in different rooms of the house at their time of death, and showing no evidence of having been moved post-mortem. But the family's youngest, Steven, had a number of Pokemon cards and action figures in his room, prominently featuring the franchise's most well-known creature, Pikachu. This shape-shifting, rampaging killer was caught not long afterwards when a full-size pony suddenly manifested in the home of another suburban family, thankfully causing no fatalities this time, and galloped off into the woods. Seeing as the Foundation was already keeping a close watch on the area to make sure they caught any more strange activity, they were able to quickly engage with and capture this strange entity. It was then sedated and sent back into containment at the iconic Site-19. The creature is now known as SCP-137. So you're probably wondering, what exactly is happening here? What are the anomalous traits of SCP-137 that appear to express themselves in such random and violent ways? While it may seem that 137's abilities are as diverse as they are dangerous, it actually only has one very simple anomalous power. It possesses the toys of children and transforms them into their real-life equivalent. A teddy bear became an actual bear. A stuffed gorilla became an actual gorilla. Toys of He-Man and a member of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles became murderous sword wielders. And Pikachu became a wild animal with powerful electrical abilities. The SCP doesn't appear to be inherently violent either. Its level of aggression appears to be in the eye of the beholder, as the attributes of the toys possessed by SCP-137 are defined by what a child perceives about said toy. For example, a pretend gun becomes a real one, capable of firing real bullets. Toys of dangerous animals become equally deadly in their real SCP-137 counterpart. Warriors and soldiers become powerful killing machines. However, this works both ways. Adorable or harmless characters remain equally adorable and harmless when SCP-137 possesses them. It seems as though the entity that possesses these toys doesn't even have a consciousness. It only takes up the mental attributes of its hosts. Incidentally, this was actually a crucial factor in devising the proper containment method for SCP-137 within Site-19. Through testing, the Foundation discovered that SCP-137's anomalous range is at least 250 meters, with a possible upper limit of 500 meters. In order to keep the creature in a consistent and harmless form, the Foundation forbids any unauthorized toy from being placed within the 500-meter radius of SCP-137. Essentially, the Foundation has boxed SCP-137 into a corner, meaning that any toy placed within its anomalous proximity is its only option. In this case, the Foundation has locked SCP-137 into a form of a wholesome princess doll, identifying itself as Princess Blossom. When asked about its identity in this form, the creature seems to have no awareness whatsoever of its anomalous nature. SCP-137 truly believes it is Princess Blossom while occupying this form, repeatedly asking interviewing researchers whether they're her prince finally coming to save her from this prison. Sadly for 137, her prince will never come, but perhaps she'll spend every day looking at her own cell door and hoping, being physically incapable of knowing any better. But of course, you're not here to engage with the heady existential realities of a shape and personality shifting anomaly. Like any reasonable person in this situation, of course, you want to hear about the experiment logs, and find out just how far this entity's ability to anomalously take the forms of living toys can stretch. And don't worry, we won't disappoint you on that one either. SCP-137 has some of the most insane testing logs we've ever seen, and we're going to share them with you right now. The last one is a real doozy. First, overeager researchers made the terrible decision to introduce a toy plane into the testing chamber with SCP-137. How could this possibly go wrong, right? Well, here's how. The toy plane was possessed by SCP-137, which transformed into a full-sized F-16 jet. This jet then attempted to fly off while inside the testing chamber, resulting in it flying into the side of the chamber and exploding, causing a massive amount of damage to Foundation property. Whenever one of SCP-137's toy hosts is destroyed, it returns to being a toy. In this case, after the smoke cleared, a small cluster of broken plastic was laying on the floor. The researchers were then forbidden from testing any toys with jet engines or missiles, but they didn't tell them anything about toy race cars. It seemed these researchers really were children at heart. They were amazed when the toy car turned into a full-size Ferrari, then plowed into the wall at high speeds, exploding. Vehicle tests were suspended after this. The next test was actually kind of an accident. An attending agent had an amusing little keyring shaped like an alligator when entering the 250 meter range of SCP-137. You can probably guess what happened next. Because the keyring was technically close enough to a toy, SCP-137 took it over and transformed it into a 6-meter long saltwater crocodile. It then lashed out, attacking and devouring nearby researchers. 14 were dead by the time Foundation security officers managed to safely enter the scene and terminate the crocodile. At that point, searches were intensified for all personnel intended on working in SCP-137's 500-meter danger zone. Next, an action figure of an American soldier, complete with a toy rifle. What do you think happened next? If you're guessing that this toy became a violent full-size soldier that then went on to murder a number of Foundation employees before being taken out by several Foundation agents, then you can take any prize from the middle shelf. Just make sure you don't bring your prize too close to SCP-137, or disaster could strike again. After this, a toy police officer was possessed by SCP-137. He began by searching the testing facility for perps, and encouraging the researchers to stay away from drugs. This seemed almost charming to begin with. until he pulled out his gun and murdered two researchers claiming they were criminals. He handcuffed a third before finally being terminated by Foundation security officers. After this, researchers on the SCP-137 project decided to veer away from testing on violent or dangerous toys, and instead brought in a stuffed panda, the sweetest and cuddliest of all bears. Everyone agreed that this would be a pleasant change when SCP-137 transformed into one of the big, adorable beasts. One researcher, overjoyed at the presence of the panda, accepted a hug from it. The panda hugged far harder than anticipated, breaking three of the researchers' ribs. It was terminated by Foundation security officers soon afterwards. It turned out that the anomalous effects of SCP-137 also applied to non-sentient toys. For example, a box filled with Lego blocks became real terracotta bricks and construction materials. And a yo-yo, even when placed on a hook on the wall with nobody nearby, continued to perform sick yo-yo tricks with reckless abandon. The penultimate test performed on SCP-137 involved an action figure of a character known as Dr. Selenium, advertised as the smartest man on Earth. However, when SCP-137 transformed this into a real-life Dr. Selenium, the Foundation discovered that SCP-137 couldn't actually imitate more ephemeral qualities like incredible intelligence. This Dr. Selenium clone simply walked around, constantly talking about how intelligent he was rather than actually demonstrating that intelligence. He was probably the kind of guy who comments first on YouTube videos. And finally, the strangest test of all. The Foundation constantly needs to worry about moles and double-crossers in their midst. They have tests to figure out the presence of double agents working for groups of interest, like the Chaos Insurgency or the Serpent's Hand. But one group that they didn't have tests for were bronies, adult male fans of the cartoon My Little Pony based on the popular toy series. And it just so happened that one of the researchers on the SCP-137 case was indeed a brony. That's why he snuck a doll of the purple pony Twilight Sparkle into the testing chamber, causing SCP-137 to possess it and turn into the real thing. He engaged in a somewhat flirtatious conversation with the talking pony, leading to the pony offering to take the researcher back to her castle so they could hang out. After the testing session ended, the researcher was removed from the project and then reprimanded by his superiors for using an anomaly to fulfill his personal interests. But working at the Foundation is an incredibly hard job, with the risk of death lurking around every corner. So who can really blame a guy for wanting to hang out with his favorite cartoon character between sessions with 096 and 682? I mean me, but hey, I'm just the narrator. Which toy would you like SCP-137 to possess and transform into a real-life counterpart? Let us know in the comments below. Then go check out All the Little Misters Explained and SCP-136 Naked Doll for more terrifying, anomalous toys.